All right. Welcome, everyone, to Connections Between Brazilian Choro and American Jazz, presented by Dr. Andy Connell. This lecture is the third in Educarte's Choro lecture series, which has been running this fall at the Old Parish House in College Park. We've been in person, but tonight we wanted to bring Andy in. He's in Michigan, so we're doing this, this lecture tonight virtually. Educarte is a cultural arts education nonprofit organization that was founded by myself and my co-founder, Pablo de Oliveira, that builds communities by connecting artists and audiences. And we engage our audiences in performances and lectures and educational programming that highlight the value of cultural expression. We are recording tonight, so please be aware, and please keep your microphones muted until we open up for the Q&A. Feel free to post comments and questions in the chat. The lecture tonight was made possible by a grant from the Maryland Humanities with funding received from the Maryland Historical Trust in the Maryland Department of Planning. And tonight we are very pleased to present virtually this lecture by Andy Connell. Andy is an ethnomusicologist whose primary research is in Brazilian popular instrumental music, focusing on issues of identity and musical globalization. He has recent articles published in Music Cultures of Latin America, Global Effects, UCLA's Past and Present, and Women and Music in America since 1900. He has given presentations at various national and international conferences, including the Society for Ethnomusicology and the International Council of Traditional Music. His current scholarly activities include completing a book on Brazilian jazz. As a performer, he plays saxophone and clarinet in ensembles ranging from jazz to classical chamber music to Brazilian choro, of course. A professor at James Madison University, he teaches courses in American music, the history of jazz, world music, and he coaches small jazz ensembles. And I will pass it over to Andy.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Really a pleasure to be here, and thanks to Kate and to Pablo for inviting me to do this lecture, and this kind of continuation of those of you who've seen the previous lectures, which are archived on, also on YouTube, I believe. By Tom Rode and Brian McCann. Hopefully this lecture will have some connections to those, as well as the next lecture in the series on Pixinguinha by Ceylon Mitchell. I have kind of slow internet here, so me and Kate are gonna do kind of a dance where she's gonna show the slides from hers, and then we're gonna kind of share to me so I can play the music. So there'll be a little bit of bouncing around going on between us. Hopefully there won't be too many delays, and hopefully my video will keep playing. It may freeze at various times. So it's the Zoom world we live in. I think all the sound will be fine. So we're gonna listen to a lot of really good music. So maybe we could just sort of share that kind of opening screen there. So one thing, jazz and Brazilian music have really been connected since the early 20th century. I mean, the recordings are reaching Brazil by the teens in the 20th century. I mean, and basically it comes down, I mean, Dizzy Gillespie once said, and he was talking about Cuba, but it could apply to just about any place in the world, that, you know, they know more about our music than we know about them. I mean, all over the world, including Brazil, people have long been aware of American music. And this kind of this sort of connection between jazz and choro is something that a lot of Brazilians have actually mentioned to me. They use these kind of metaphors that choro is Brazilian blues, or it's Brazilian jazz, or Brazilian ragtime, or Brazilian Dixieland, are all some of the kind of phrases I've heard associated with this. And in many ways, kind of these commonalities, you know, these are both kind of hybrid traditions. They both come out of the mixing of the African diaspora with kind of European music, this kind of mixing together that's expressed throughout the Americas. they're kind of mixing kind of some European instrumentation, functional harmony with kind of from, you know, syncopation, polyrhythms, and cyclical forms, and the kind of communal creation of ensembles you find from kind of West African cultures there. They both feature improvisation. They both have a kind of extensive repertoire of tunes that allow people to basically jam together. This kind of this idea, this jam session ethos, in Brazil they call a roda de choro, a choro circle, where people get together And if, even if they haven't met each other, they have this shared huge repertoire of tunes they can play together in the same way that jazz musicians can do. They, you know, the standards of the 30s and 40s, as well as, you know, original tunes by jazz musicians that everybody knows. You have this shared kind of repertoire that in some ways kind of creates the form of musicians playing together. Both the terms choro and jazz are is really more a way of playing than an actual style. I mean, there's not a specific rhythm or a specific tune that's really associated with the music. It's more a way of interpreting kind of popular music that really makes jazz what it is, makes choro what it is. Then it's all really created through the oral tradition of everybody improvising together and kind of creating this language that comes to identify those styles. So even though they are different musics, they have kind of share a lot of these commonalities because they're coming from similar roots, this kind of mix of European and African musics and cultures that kind of blend together over a long period of time, taking different routes. So let's go to the next slide here. And so as early as 1919, you have American jazz bands touring Europe. There's a group, this band leader named Harry Kosarin, and has brought his what he called his ragtime band. They appeared in Sao Paulo and Rio and were a big hit. This picture here shows one of the kind of the main composers in choro, saxophonist and flutist Pixinguinha, who in the 20s formed various groups that were he called his jazz bands. And they had a kind of this kind of jazz. You can see this, the instrumentation. You have drums, piano, banjo, saxophone, trumpet, trombone, and this sort of fun sort of posing of the band, which you'd find kind of American jazz groups posing this way too. So you have this kind of influence, and just the visual and the instrumentation has a big influence on choro musicians. There were a number of kind of American-style jazz bands that were all the rage in Brazil in the 20s. I mean, you had among the ones that were kind of making records, the jazz band Brasil América, Orquestra Ideal jazz band Sul América, Romeo Silva. Romeo Silva was actually a saxophonist who claimed to have introduced the saxophone to Brazil in 1911. And he toured the U.S. and Europe a number of times, often with backing from the Brazilian government. I recorded with Josephine Baker, the great dancer in Paris, and then came to the United States in 1932 as part of for the Olympics there. They had basically a band. The Brazilians brought a band with them along with the athletes. And he ended up staying there for like 3 years and then came back to Brazil, bringing a couple different American musicians with him, a singer named Lewis Cole and a saxophonist and clarinetist named Booker Pittman, who actually stayed in Brazil, lived the rest of his life there, and was a big influence on a number of Brazilian musicians. And he himself kind of played jazz and bossa nova and some choro, recorded some of that. And Pixinguinha himself was recording a number of swing numbers along with his own choros in the 1920s. Though the Brazilians didn't call it swing, they call it foxtrot, a fox. That was kind of, when the Brazilian play a swing rhythm, they call it a fox, foxtrot. So some of the tunes he played, Vaughan and Ten, When Buddha Smile, Trouble, so had English titles even to kind of further identify them with jazz. And again, I'm not going to really play much Pixinguinha because that's kind of the next lecture in this series, so I don't want to kind of step on the toes of that lecture here. So let's just go one more slide and another picture of Pixinguinha here with Louis Armstrong. And this is probably, you know, it's a great picture. I love this picture. This was probably the late 50s when Louis was touring, maybe on a State Department tour. I don't know the exact date of this. And two kind of icons of music. I mean, two of them, I mean, Louis Armstrong, as much as anybody, is responsible for the shape of American popular music, and Pixinguinha was certainly one of the great innovators of Brazilian popular music. So the two of them together, kind of a match of these two beloved, and both were beloved figures as well. So now, big band and swing were very popular in the 1930s and 40s in Brazil. I mean, Brazilians love to dance, and they love to dance to kind of all the kind of swing hits that Americans are listening to. One of the places they would hear it was on Rádio Nacional, the national radio station, which broadcast kind of a variety of music shows, all with live music. They also had variety shows, soap operas, news programs. But it was really the kind of music that really drew people into the radio. And because it was all live, the national radio employed over 160 musicians, 90 vocalists, and they had a large, like a Western style classical orchestra. They had various kind of small ensembles that would play choro or samba, what they called conjunto regionais, regional bands, basically. Usually would play with no music, would basically just kind of make up arrangements on the fly. And they had a jazz style big band of saxophones, trombones, and trumpets, generally playing kind of Portuguese versions of American hits. I mean, American music still kind of dominated a lot of the music that was being played on the radio. And even today, you listen to like the equivalent of top 40 radio in Brazil, you're going to hear a lot of European and American music there. The National Radio even had a cowboy yodeler, went by Bob Nelson. I mean, obviously not his real name, but, you know, so they kind of picked that up from a kind of American versions of this. So some of this swing, these big bands, I want to kind of play a couple artists who are kind of working in that arena. So let's go to the next slide here. So actually go back and share it again. I want to kind of look at Severino Araújo and then I'll play it. So, okay. So Severino Araújo was a clarinetist and a composer and a band leader from Pernambuco, which is in the northeast of Brazil. And he basically joined and then later led this big band called the Orquestra Tabajara. And you can see some pictures of him there. I mean, he was a clarinetist and his heroes were Benny Goodman and Artie Shaw. So he's listening to that kind of music and that's shaping his playing. And again, this was a band that had four trumpets, three trombones, five saxophones and a rhythm section. So very much a typical American big band style there. And while he was in Paraíba, they primarily played kind of swing arrangements from the same as what they heard on the radio. But he, in 1945, he moved the band south to Rio, moved to Rio, which was at the time was the capital and the cultural center. and there he starts really bringing more of his own compositions, many of them choros for a big band, or his arrangements of samba and other tunes. I'm going to play a couple things here by him. The first is an arrangement he made of Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. And we'll just listen to part of this. So now you can, I guess we can switch the share here so I can kind of share my iTunes. We'll get a better sound this way. Hopefully my video is still playing. I'm not freezing too much here. So it's just a little bit of a Rhapsody in Blue here. So Orchestra Tabaj. Basically a samba arrangement of Rhapsody in Blue. Swings pretty hard. It's a great arrangement. I love that. So this kind of, he's taking kind of these kind of hits, sort of something from America, but putting it in this Brazilian context. And then he's writing his own choros. And we're going to listen to kind of one of his standard tunes. His best known tune is Espinha de Bacalhau, which is this virtuosic tune that is very commonly played in Brazil, but it's a pretty hard tune to play. So this kind of shows off his clarinet playing, but again, this is a version of it in this played by Orquestra Tabajara, so a choro in a big band context. Thank you. Okay. So, somebody said they couldn't really see my screen, which is okay. As long as you can hear it, fine. So, the sound was coming through fine, right? Hopefully. Okay. All right.
Sounds great. Sounds
Is it
great.
loud? Okay,
Yeah.
good. Good. I'm glad. So, again, from my end, probably when I share my screen, you may not see it because of my slow internet. As long as we can hear it, then we can enjoy the music, and it's so cool, right? So he's definitely, as somebody pointed out with the earlier version of Raphael says, the syncopation that the Tabajara Orchestra was nothing like American rhythm, right? They're playing samba, they're taking the kind of the form of Rhapsody in Blue, but it's certainly put all the rhythms and all the writing is definitely very Brazilian, but using this kind of tools coming from American jazz and swing, right? As far as the orchestration. Right. So let's, why don't you share again, Kate, and we'll go on to the next slide of Garotu. Okay. So now we're kind of moving into the, a little bit into the 1950s. We're going to listen to here. We're going to look at another artist who's very kind of, is mixing together kind of American music, jazz and harmonies and Brazilian music is Garotu. I mean, his real name's Anabel Augusto Sardinha. I was born to a musical family in São Paulo, and he starts playing banjo very young. In fact, his nickname, he was performing when he was like a 13 or 14, is a moleque do banjo. So basically the kind of the ragamuffin, the kid with the banjo, you can see there. And then he basically learned most of the other string instruments associated with Brazilian music, guitar, cavaquinho, mandolin, just a really multi-instrumentalist who could kind of play anything with strings. And he starts composing in the 1930s. And in the 1930s, he's working in the studios and on the radio programs in both São Paulo and Rio, becomes kind of a mainstay there. And his tunes have kind of advanced harmonies. In many ways, he's kind of laying the groundwork for the kind of harmonic forms you'll find in bossa nova later, which are really borrowing from kind of American using more kind of extended harmonies. And he's already doing this in some of his tunes early in the 30s and 40s. And then in the 1940s, he comes to the US as part of Carmen Miranda's band, the Banda de Lua, the Moon Band, and stays in the United States for a while. So he's hearing all this American music, kind of brings that back with him when he comes back to Brazil. So I want to play one of his tunes. This is called Benny Goodman no Choro. So Benny Goodman in the Choro, you could say. So let me go and I'll share mine again so we can hear this. This is Garotu playing, sounds like a kind of electric mandolin on this. So. Thank you. cute tune, isn't it? So let's go back to the slides again. So Garotu, I mean, composed a number of different styles, but certainly was a great choro player among them. I think that might have been tenor guitar he was playing. Listening to it now again, it's, you know, he played so many different instruments. Sometimes I can't tell exactly which one he's playing, but I think that was probably the tenor guitar, which was a four string larger guitar tuned like a mandolin. So let's go to the next slide, and we'll look at another great Brazilian musician influenced by jazz, which is Cachimbinho, real name Sebastião Barros. So clarinetist and saxophonist and composer. He's from the northern state of Rio Grande do Norte. And he came down to Rio again. I mean, this was the place to go if you want to make it. And he played with Orquestra Tabajara, so he was in the saxophone section there. Also was a mainstay on the Radio Nacional, the national radio. Another band he played with, a band by a saxophonist named Fonfon, who was famous for his tune Mumurando, was also another arranger who kind of used kind of big band style horn sections in his compositions right there. And by the 1960s, he's working as an arranger, musician for TV, like TV Globo and others there. And a number of his compositions have really become choro standards. Tenebroso, Sonoroso, Caticha, and Sempre, which we're going to listen to now. And this is from a very famous record. Probably you can find it. I'm sure it's streaming. Saudade de Clarinete, which features kind of his jazz-influenced settings of choro. So this is, we'll listen to his tune, Sempre. This is Cachimbinho. Such a great tune. Cachimbinho has so many really wonderful tunes. Such a great composer. and again, you can hear the flavor. I mean, his improvisation Definitely has a little bit of kind of jazz in it, and using this kind of instrumentation, the arrangement influenced by kind of ideas coming from big band music, but obviously very much a Brazilian sound, a very the rhythmically and melodically, really a choro at heart. So cachimbinho. Okay, let's go to the next slide, and I want to talk a little bit about this kind of influence of American music. Was something that, I mean, there was a big attraction of Brazilian music to Brazilians to American music, but also an uncomfortableness with it. I mean, the kind of the idea of sort of this kind of cultural domination that the United States had, that Europe had, and so there were various people who kind of felt they had to sort of defend the traditional Brazilian music, and Choro in many ways was set up, was kind of people positioned it as this kind of roots music, roots Brazilian music, the wellspring which all kind of Brazilian popular music came from, and that it represented like this authentic Brazilian culture, what they called Brasilidade or Brazilianness, and I'll just write that, Brasilidade, and it kind of that operated in some ways as a bulwark against the sort of plague of Americanizado, this kind of American influence, Americanization. So I'll put that is in the chat as well. So there was this controversy that went on basically since the kind of the 20, even before that, over kind of foreign influence, this debate that went on of how much they, you know, Brazilians should embrace the outside, or how should she rely on kind of music from within or culture from within. And there was a whole idea of, associated with a bunch of modernist intellectuals about dealing with kind of how to create something that was very Brazilian, that was separate from kind of European culture. And in many ways, Brazil was going through the same thing we did in the United States of a post-colonial society. Who are we, right? What represents us? Is it something that's coming from the colonizers, from the kind of European colonizers? Or is there something indigenous, something that's, you know, really represents some true part of the Brazilian soul, as well as what we hear, you know, the American soul here in the United States? So and a lot of around the world, a lot of countries were going through this. We have the kind of the demise of colonialism that's starting in the early part of the 20th century, and really kind of by the end of World War II, it was the kind of the end of a lot of colonization, but countries trying to find their own identity. So even Pixinguinha at one point was accused of recycling American music with his beloved tune Carinhoso, this tune that every Brazilian knows. So there was this kind of advocates in the modernist movement of this kind of this idea called anthropophagia, and I'll write that in. If I can spell, gia, anthropophagia, which loosely translates as cultural cannibalism. Anthropophagy is cannibalism. And this kind of came from this poet, Oswald de Andrade, who wrote this kind of tongue-in-cheek poem, the Manifesto Anthropophagia, which basically had this kind of lines playing with, you know, Tupi or not Tupi, that is the question, Tupi being an Indian tribe, Amerindian tribe, that were known for their kind of cannibalizing their opponents. So this idea was this, the manifesto, part of it condemned what this kind of imported canned consciousness was kind of representing outside culture. It called for this ritual kind of cannibalization or ingestion of foreign cultural elements, which Andrade called this sacred enemy because of this sort of attraction to it and also repulsion. I mean, the modernists were kind of, they were especially attracted to the kind of European avant-garde, but were kind of uncomfortable with too much European influence in Brazil. So thus the sacred enemy. The idea by ingestion that they would kind of reinvigorate, you know, vital and varied Brazilian forms. The idea that the Brazilian kind of the Brazilians were kind of strong enough that they could withstand this and they could take any kind of outside influence and make it their own. That what would, the product of this would be inherently Brazilian, right? This is later kind of comes out in criticism by the critic José Ramos Tinoral, who railed against, actually he still rails against bossa nova as this kind of this Americanized music that was, as he said, it was divorced from true Brazilian music, which he cited was basically that kind of Afro-Brazilian samba from the hills in Rio. there. And even recently, I'd heard musicians talking about, you know, talking about other musicians as being too Berkeleyana, is what this, the idea of these, a lot of Brazilian musicians came to the United States to study the Berklee School of Music in Boston, which is famous for their jazz program, among other things. And so the feeling is some of these musicians had gone there and come back, and they technically were, could play great, but they'd lost all their Brazilian feeling. They were Berkeleyana. They were kind of Americanizado right there. So this was an kind of accusation I heard. I'm not going to name any names, but certain musicians were seen this way. Again, the idea of not having that Brazilian feeling, having too much foreign influence. So there's always sort of some sort of balance that went on here. And one of the great defenders of the tradition was the bandolim in Brazil, Jacob de Bandolim, his real name, Jacob Bittencourt. This was common for Brazilian musicians to take as their nickname the instrument they played. And a wonderful composer and player, a virtuoso on the instrument. And we think of it, along with Pixinguinha, the two main poles of Choro, the great composers that form the meat of the repertoire, Jacob's tunes and Pixinguinha's. But he had these very definite ideas of kind of what Brazilian music was and what it wasn't, and was very involved in the 1950s with a series of concerts with a group that was put together by a radio personality named Almirante called the Pessoa de Velha Guarda, the Old Guard, these concerts, in which included Pixinguinha and some older musicians. And then Jacob was part of this. He was much younger than most of them, but in many ways was one of the spokesmen of this idea of, you know, what Brazilian music was. So he was critical of bossa nova and critical of music that was too Americanized, as he said. And his group, Epoca de Ouro, the Age of Gold, became the kind of, which the group actually still exists today, is kind of the icon of traditional choro and its instrumentation, which is two guitars, a six-string guitar, a seven-string guitar, a cavaquinho, a percussion, a pandeiro instrument, and a solo instrument, you know, in this, his case, the bandolim, is sort of the iconic instrumentation of a typical choro group. Now, the irony of Jacob, who's, you know, very outspoken about what Brazilian music is and Brazilian music was, that he was a complete experimenter. You know, he experimented with different forms, with kind of more modal sections, with kind of extended harmonies, with almost kind of bluesy kind of sounds. And later, late in his career, he experimented with electronics on his instruments. So while kind of railing against these American influence, he's trying all sorts of great ideas, you know, and produces this amazing body of tunes that are so fun to play. I mean, any of you, I know I've seen some people in here who are playing choro, and they all know Jacob's music. So I'm going to play a couple different versions of a tune of his called Assignado. Let's go to the next slide too, because we're going to also listen to his, a little bit of his version. Then we're going to listen to, actually, I guess it's not there, a group by named Noam Pindago. So let's go back to Jacob's slide there. I guess I didn't put it, it comes later. I'll maybe show a picture of them, who in the 90s put out a record of all Jacob's music, but they did it with electric bass and a kind of funky rhythms on a lot of their stuff. So they kind of showed the kind of the blues and the funkiness that was in Jacob's music, and they sort of kind of put it into a 90s context. We'll exchange shares, and I'll play a little bit of Jacob's version, and then we'll listen to Noam Pindago. Okay, so. Okay, so this is Assignado, which means heated up, heated, you know, cooking, you can say. This is Jacob's version of this. Thank you. Jacob's version of this, so the original recording of his composition. So this is from 1995, Noten Pinga d'Agua. This includes includes Rogério Souza, who many of you know, kind of comes here to the United States regularly on guitar, and then Leo Lucini on bass, on electric bass, who lived in the D.C. Area for a long time, lives in New York now, but many of us I see here have played with him, a wonderful musician. So this is their version of Asignado. Thank you. Great. So, Non Pindagua's version of Asanado, and you can hear the kind of the very creative arrangement and reharmonization of some of this, and then there. So, I think Kate, let's go back to sharing your. So, those who came in late, we're kind of going back and forth to share because my internet is very slow, so it kind of works better if the kind of visuals are coming from Kate and I can play the sound from here. So sometimes we're doing a little bit of dance. So we're going to skip ahead, not the next slide, but the slide after that. We're going to move right to Hermeto Pascoal, I think. There's Nuan Ping Dog. Well, there they are. Mario Savvy, good friend of mine on saxophone there, all of them. this is a little later version of it after Leo had moved to the United States, a different bass player, Papito. So anyways, but I digress. So jump ahead. So look at Hermeto Pascoal, who's maybe Brazil's greatest jazz musician. He is from the northeast of Brazil. He's, if you can see, he's albino. So all white hair and has this kind of look that he's developed that is very kind of iconic with the long hair and the beard. And is a kind of a practitioner of instrumental style, the company called Música Instrumental Brasileira, Brazilian instrumental music. But he also grows up playing all the different music from the Northeast, but also all those choros. He knows a huge amount of choros and a large amount of American jazz tunes. I mean, he actually lived in the United States for a while. He recorded with Miles Davis, with Cannonball Adderley and others. Is a musician really on that level, I would say. The other picture of him is with his great group, O Grupo, who he recorded with. Still a version of it exists today. He's still putting out great records now and is in there. And some of the other members of the group now live in the United States. That's Jovino on the right. Yes, Jovino lives in Seattle right there. All around the piano. This will be sometime probably the kind of late 80s, I would imagine, this picture was taken. I'm not sure. But certainly he can play choros. So I'm going to play a couple of different choros by him. The first one is called Salve Copinha. And Copinha was a great choro flutist from Rio. And when Hermeto moved south from the Northeast, he'd been living in Pernambuco and playing there. He moves to Rio first, and he plays in Copinha's band for him. So Copinha was one of his employer for a little while. And this is dedicated to him, Salve Copinha. Nicholas Copia was his name. So I'll listen to this first. Thank you. Okay. What a flourish at the end. Such a creative individual, creative tune, Salve Copinha. I'm going to play another one by him. This is Intocavo. And this features the great guitarist Rafael Rabello, one of the great seven-string guitarists of the, basically from the 70s on. Unfortunately died way too young in the 90s, and came in to read this very, actually pretty complicated tune. And they said he came in the studio basically, you know, and sight read the tune and recorded it in one take and then left. You know, he's just such a badass. So you'll hear the seven string guitar in this along with his ugrupo. So this is Intocavo. Okay, Kate, how much time do we have? I see it's about seven, so I could go on all night, but I don't want to go on all night, or then I'll just kind of flatten you guys if I do that. Maybe we can go back to sharing the screen here, or
yeah, I think we can finish up. You just have a couple slides left, and then maybe we can open it up for questions.
Sure. Let's just go, we'll kind of listen to one more thing, and then we'll do questions here. So let's go to the next slide here. And we'll listen to some more Rafael Rabello. And this is a duet he did with the great saxophonist Paulo Moura. And this is also another musician who kind of works in the musica instrumental area, kind of plays jazz, is definitely very influenced. One of his influences was Benny Goodman coming up. But also is a great choro player. So a lot of these musicians, like Hermeto and Paulo Moura, were not primarily choro musicians, but they knew the repertoire and played it and wrote, especially Hermeto wrote these wonderful tunes, the couple that have become standards of the choro repertoire here. And so this is one, I'm going to play this great record they made, a duo record, Deutsch and Ramal's two brothers. And so their version of the great Pixinguinha tune, Uma Zero, One Time Zero. This shows basically it's definitely a straight show, but they're very free. The way they play, the way they improvise together, the way they respond together. There's all this wonderful interplay between these two real masters of the time. And again, like Rafael died way too young. You can see his dates there. It was not very old when he died. It was a great loss to Brazilian music in general. But you can really feel his spirit coming through this. And Paulo Moura himself, just a great improviser and kind of a great guy. So let's change the sharing here so I can kind of share and we'll listen to this and then I'll take questions or suggestions or anything you want. Okay, so this is Uma Zero. This was actually written by Pixinguinha as a response to a result of a soccer game, a South American Cup against Uruguay, I guess, which his team won, the Brazilians won. And there's a little Easter egg in this. You'll hear in the melody, the little di-da-dup, 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 this was his tribute to a soccer announcer, radio announcer, that whenever his team would score a goal, he had a harmonica, and he would play this little phrase on the harmonica. So Pixinguinha snuck in his phrase into this tune. And you'll hear this kind of near the beginning. So this is Uma Zero, Paulo Moura and Rafael Rabello. Just incredible, right? What a wonderful players. So that's kind of what I was going to play today. That I had some other, like I said, I could go on for days listening to stuff. I don't get tired of it. Certainly been my obsession for many years. So hopefully you got some of that. So we'll kind of take questions. You can either kind of unmute or you can put things in the chat. I mean, I see one question here. And obviously music can be many things, but at what point does it speak of another, what are the essential artistic, musical, and cultural events it must have? Wow, that's a big question. in a sense, that's what the debate is about, that I kind of talked about a little bit in the middle of the lecture, of what are the boundaries? Are there boundaries, right? And there's not agreed upon boundaries of what that is. You know, I mean, people are always kind of pushing against it. And, you know, the many young musicians are writing new tunes and experimenting. So I'm not even sure how to answer that question. Certainly, I mean, I think of that group, Noam Pingadagwa, that I played for you, who are, you know, all friends of mine. And but I remember kind of listening to them at one point, and another friend of mine, a short musician who was a much more traditional kind of musician, actually kind of came up to me and said, you know that Noam Pingadagwa, that's not Choro, right? You know that's not Choro. So, you know. And, you know, I mean, that was, for him, that was like a bridge too far. But for a lot of people, you know, they're a popular group at the time, you know. So I'm not sure if there's a direct answer to that question, except that this is a debate that goes on, not just in Choro, but in a lot of different styles around the world of, you know, as people kind of try new things, push the boundaries, you know, when does something cease being defined by a particular style and become a brand new style? I mean, we see this debate going on in jazz, in pop music and folk music. I mean, you think of Bob Dylan going electric at Newport, which horrified a lot of kind of folk purists. So that's an interesting question. So yeah, I mean, you, when you draw, where do you put the labels? That's a good question. And I don't think I have a definitive answer for that. Right, so Rafael says rhythms based on Afro-Brazilian kind of rhythm. I mean, yeah, I mean, obviously when we think of Brazilian music, there's certain kind of genres and styles that are definitely Brazilian. I mean, like samba or, you know, frevo, baião, all these different styles which are definitely Brazilian, and certain instruments and a certain kind of sound, which certainly a lot of American musicians are playing this music, and some playing very well, often. But it's very hard to get kind of the grooves with the right sound, right? It's like speaking another language. I mean, when I play with Brazilians, I had fun playing with them, but often they'd comment on, you know, Andy, he plays, yeah, jazz choro, you know, gringo choro. I mean, it's good. We like it, but it's definitely different, you know? So, you know, as close as I thought I was coming, I was not close enough for some people, but that was okay too, right? Right, so Rafael's naming a bunch of different kind of genres there that could be defined as Brazilian, right? But within Brazil, there's debate about, you know, what actually defines a style as far as, or how much innovation becomes something different, right? Other questions? Comments or well, if there are no questions, I guess we can call it a night, right? We can all go get a drink. I wish I was there. We could all go out for a drink together. You know.
That would be wonderful if we could do that. We have been doing those at the in-person events, and it's been great.
Sorry, I'm not there.
No, it's okay. This has been wonderful, Andy. Thank you so much. Thank you everybody for coming tonight. Our next lecture in the series, and the last one in the series, will take place on December 3rd, and that one will be in person at the Old Parish House in College Park, and it will also be recorded. So if you are in California or you can't make it in person, just register and you can receive the link, and I'll put this information in the chat. And the lecturer will be flutist Ceylon Mitchell, who is a DMA candidate at the University of Maryland, and he will be presenting about Pixinguinha, which Andy mentioned and, you know, didn't say too much about, because we want to save that for the next lecture. And Ceylon will be talking about his work and also demonstrating some of Pixinguinha's compositional innovations. So if there are no other questions, you can always send questions to me and I'll relay them to Andy, and we'll send out this recording and the playlist afterwards by tomorrow. And yeah, thank you all so much for coming out, and thank you, Andy, for presenting for us tonight.
Thank you for having me. It was really fun. You know, as I said, I could talk about this stuff all day, listen to this music. So hopefully everybody enjoyed it. And that's all I have to say.
Thanks, Andy.
So good night, everybody. Thank you for coming.
Andy, did Louis Armstrong tour Brazil a lot? Did he?
I'm not sure. I'm sure he did tour. I'm not sure how many times. I know he did tours. It did a lot of State Department tours around the world. I mean, jazz was kind of set up as this sort of representation of democracy. But one of the places they went was throughout Latin America, also to, you know, to Russia, to Africa, to the Middle East. So I'm assuming that might, because there's other pictures from that tour where he's with the Brazilian president Kubitschek at the time. So I'm sure that was probably a State Department tour when he, you know, got those wonderful pictures with Pixinguinha. So.